Welcome to chapter 8 of the Introduction to Python and Programming course. This chapter is on mappings and sets. So, what are mappings? Well, for the purpose of this chapter, I want you to think of mappings as basically something you all know. So, here I have a coordinate axis, I have x, I have y. And now, the thing is this. You are used to drawing functions as usually a continuous line. For example, a parabola like this. Now, computers cannot be continuous, as we will see in a moment. But where's the mapping here? Well, a function is nothing but a mapping from x to y. So an f is a function that maps the x to the y's. And usually we write that as a lowercase y is equal to a function of x. So we know that from high school. And as I said, this function is continuous, and computers cannot be continuous. Why can they not be continuous? Well, as we learned in chapter 5 on numbers, we only have a finite number of bits available in our computer's memory to model numbers. So let's, for a moment, just take the whole numbers. Maybe let's have a negative 1 here, a negative 2 here. We have the 0 here, of course. We have the plus 1, and we have a plus 2. And then whatever the values are here, let's say this here is a 1. And then this may be a 1 half here. And then this may be a 1. And so what does that lead to? That means is if I only look at the discrete values of this mapping here, I would have a mapping that looks somewhat like this. So we have a table where we have all the x's, negative 2, negative 1, 0, plus 1, plus 2, and they are mapped to the y's. And just in the example I said, I made this up. This is mapped to 1, this here is mapped to 0.5, the 0 is mapped, okay, maybe should not have put the 1 here. Maybe I should make a 2 here and a 1.5. So we just make this a 2 and this a 1.5. And then the 0 is mapped to a 1. And the plus 1 is mapped to a 1.5. And the plus 2 is mapped to a 2. It doesn't really matter. The only thing that matters is that we see that a function is just a mapping from x's to y's. And this is basically conceptually what we want to model in a programming language as well. And what do we see from here? We see that the axes, they are unique. That's an important fact. And the y's, what about them? They may not be unique. This is just how functions are defined in math. And there are certainly other types of mappings, but this is a mapping in the way we are taught in math. And it's exactly this what we want to mimic in a computer, so this kind of mapping. So how do we do that in Python? Well, mainly, we do that with the so-called dictype. Dictype stands for dictionary. And as we can guess, a dictionary is something where we can look up something. And this is exactly what we will do. So in a mapping, I look up the x's. And when I look up an x, that means I read the corresponding y to the x. That's what the lookup means. And so this is what we do with the dictype. So let's see how we can model a dictionary. So throughout this chapter, I will have two main examples that are simple and one example that is a bit more evolved, but also quite simple. So the first simple example is the dictionary called two words. And what does it do? It maps the integers 0, 1, 2 to the strings 0, 1, 2. Okay? So syntactically, how do we write it? We write it with curly braces. And then, as we learned before, the white space in between opening and closing delimiters is basically ignored in Python. So we could also write this on entirely one line, but it makes sense because we're mapping x's to y's, so to say, to write it in maybe a tabular fashion here so that we can read the source code in an easier way. So the curly braces, that is what constitutes the literal notation for dictionaries. And then let's look at each of the lines. So we map a zero, the integer zero, to the string zero. So we write on the left-hand side the number zero, then we write a colon. So colon belongs to the syntax. Then we write the right-hand side to which we map, and then we write a comma, because then the entry is over, so to say. And then this way we specify all the mappings in the two words dictionary. Okay, regarding some terminology, this is a dictionary, as we have learned, and the values, the x's that are mapped to some other values, they are called the keys. And on the right-hand side, we have the values that mimic the y's. They are called the values. So a note, just to reiterate the point, when we had, let's say, an object, any object, which object do we take? Let's just take, for illustration purposes, the object 10.0, the float 10.0. Whenever I create an object, we said that any object has three properties. So the first one was always the identity. So that would be the address here. The second object, the second property of any object would be the type. And then what was the third object, the third property I was always talking about? Well, we referred to this as the value. And what did we mean? We meant the semantic value of the object. So whatever is inside the object in memory, and whatever that means to us humans, that is what we mean by the value of an object. Okay, so this is one meaning of the word value. Going back to chapter one. And now, as I just mentioned, in the terminology for dictionaries, we will say that a dictionary is a mapping from keys to values. So note how I reuse the word value here. And value now has a double meaning. We have to be aware of that. So first, it means the semantic value every object has. And secondly, it means the role an object can play within a dictionary. And the strings 0, 1, 2, they play the roles of values within this dictionary. And the objects 0, 1, 2, the integers, they play the roles of the keys in the dictionary, okay? So just to get this right away, so that you are not confused when you're listening to me now. So whenever I say value, you have to always decide, what am I talking about? Do I mean the value of an object, or do I mean the values inside a dictionary? These are two different things here. Okay, and just in the way I created this dictionary, let's create another dictionary, and I call it from words, and we just do the opposite. So mathematically, I know that this is not a mathematical function here, but let's say if this were a mathematical function, what would from words and to words be? Well, they would be inverses of each other, right? So we map from 0, 1, 2 integer to 0, 1, 2 string, and then here we map 0, 1, 2 the strings to the 0, 1, 2 integer. Okay, so inverse function. And in order for a function to be invertible in math, we remember that the y's must also be unique. Otherwise, we couldn't invert the function. But here in Python, we can actually deal with that. But this will also, we will look into this. So it's not, we're not looking at functions here, but I just give you the idea of a function here to give you a reference of something that you know from high school of how you should think about dictionaries. So let's see what else can we tell about dictionaries. Well, of course, every dictionary is an object, as anything in Python. So it has an ID. It also has a type, and the type is, of course, dict here. And then it has a value. Note the first meaning of the word value here. And the value, the semantic value, so to say, of the dictionary is just the mapping itself. So here I'm given out the value of the object as a literal. A literal means I can copy-paste this here back into a code cell, and I will get a new object with the same value. That's what happens when I get back, whenever I get back the value of an object as a literal. Okay, so in other words, we speak of this as the literal notation of the object. Now, as we have seen in previous chapters, most of the types, of the built-in data types in Python, they have a literal notation with which we can create them. However, they also have a constructor with which we can create them. And so does the dictionary type as well. So we have a dict constructor. And the dict constructor can be used in different ways. So one way to use the dict constructor is we pass it an iterable that contains or that produces two tuples. And the first element inside the tuples is the key, and the second element will become the value, the role of the value. So in other words, here I have the brackets. So this constitutes a list. So I'm basically passing only one list to the dict constructor, and the list is, of course, iterable. And then the requirement is that the iterable consists of tuples that whose first element become the keys and the second elements become the value. So if I execute this, I will get back basically the same dictionary as seen before, just from a different notation. And then I said that the dict constructor is quite versatile. So we can use it in a different way. We can treat it as a as if we called a function and provide keyword arguments. And the keyword arguments here, 0, 1, 2, they are not strings here, actually. So this is just kind of like a variable here. But they will become strings due to how Python is built. But so the keywords here, they will become the keys. And the arguments that we pass in by the keyword, these will become the values. So in other words, this will also give us a dictionary which looks the same. So we have different ways of constructing dictionaries. Okay. These were the easy examples. And let's now look at a more realistic example of a dictionary that models what we will call nested data. And what you're about to see is a format of data which is quite common to see if you ask for data from a web API, for example. So oftentimes, when you download a third-party package to, you know, for example, make a request to the Google Maps API or the Yelp API or the Uber API or wherever, then usually the data that comes back will be represented in a nested structure, and an example of which I provide to you here next. So let's try to analyze this. So at first, this is one statement. We see that in the first line, the statement begins. It's an assignment statement, and we know that the right-hand side of the assignment statement is evaluated first. That means the entire code here that is marked will be evaluated first, and only after that, when the object that this evaluates to has been created in memory, the people variable will be assigned to this object, or a reference from the people variable will be made to the new object. The new object will be a dictionary, of course. And this dictionary will have three keys called mathematicians, physicists, and programmers. That's it. So, and then these names or these strings are mapped to what? They are mapped to lists, okay? So the mathematicians, the string mathematicians is mapped to a list that contains, as we will see, two more dictionaries. And of course, each dictionary within this list models a person. That's what we can tell already. And then we see that there are two mathematicians on the list, so to say. And then physicists is mapped to an empty list. So that means currently we have no physicists in our people list or in our people dictionary. And then we have a third kind of list here. We have a programmer's list, and this is a list as well. So in that way, the data structure is homogeneous. And then within this list, there is only one dictionary. And we end it here with a comma. That's a good convention to do this comma. The commas here at the end, sometimes some of them would not be necessary. I put them there anyways to make it look unique. It also has some other advantages that are not so important. So, but again, this is also one person. And then we see that the three, the three innermost dictionaries that model people are the persons that go by the name Gilbert Strang, who is a professor of math at MIT. Then we have Leonard Euler, one of the most famous, I guess, and most influential mathematicians of all time. And then in the programmers list, we have, of course, Guido van Rossum, who invented Python. And then, so let's look at the inner dictionaries. What can we tell about them? Well, what we can say is that every person has two attributes, so to say. Every person has a name. And here we just summarize first name, last name into one field. And then every person, again, has an attribute called emails, plural, which, again, is mapped to a list. And the list contains strings, like, for example, the email address gilbert@mit.edu. I'm pretty sure this email address does not work. I hope it does not work, because I didn't ask Gilbert Strang if I can put his email address here as an example. And then regarding Guido van Rossum, so Guido has two email addresses. Why? Well, he has, of course, his python.org email address. And then until last year, end of last year, he worked for Dropbox, which is why I made up his second email address, guido@dropbox.com. And so the question is now, what am I modeling here? I am modeling here a nested data structure. And basically, we see that this has some similarity to the sequences we talked about in chapter 7, in that it basically consists of elements. And the elements are kind of like the dictionaries. And structure-wise, the elements look alike. So they are structured in the same way. They have the same fields. The email's attribute is mapped always to a list, even if the list is empty. But it's still a list that we map to. And so this is data that is basically in a format which is similar to how data is stored in a database, in an SQL database, a normalized database. And again, if you make an API request to many of the web APIs out there, you will get oftentimes data that looks like this. You know, if this were, let's say, modeling Google Maps or something, then this would maybe be a list of places in a certain area where we did a search via the API or something like that. Okay, so this is how we can model, you know, data in a program. And there is one problem set on the exercises list that makes you work with such data. So you will look into this in detail, and we will also use this example throughout this chapter here. And now, because people is kind of hard to read. Oh, I did not execute the code cell, so now people is defined. Now, this is hard to read. Why? Because the way Python by default prints out a nested data structure is usually very hard to read, because there is no line breaks and nothing in it. However, the standard library offers a pprint module, and which has a pprint function. A pprint stands for pretty print. And I can pretty print with some settings, and I get back the nested data structure in a readable way, I would say. So it's like what we have here at the end of the day is like a directory, right? A directory of people and ways to contact them. So the question is now, because we care about this course, how are dictionaries modeled in memory? How do they work in memory? So let's look at first some observations we make, and then I will tell you how they work. So before, we have seen dictionaries that map numbers, integers, to strings, and also that map strings to numbers. And also in the last example with people, we mapped strings to lists, basically, and also strings to other strings. So now let's try to map a list of two strings to a list of two numbers. This will make sense, right? If I have a dictionary to words and from words that maps individual words to numbers, why would we not just be able to map a couple or a pair of words or numbers? So let's try what happens. And we get a type error, and it says unhashable type list. So there are two lists in this expression. One on the left-hand side for the key, and one on the right-hand side for the value within the dictionary. So we are not yet sure which of the two lists causes the problem. The solution will be the left-hand side, and as we shall see. And then let's see at another property that we have to understand. So I create a dictionary which maps 0 to 1, 0 to 0, 1 to 1, 2 to 2, and then just for illustration purposes, maps the string 0 again, and this time to the number 3. This is down here. And now, so basically we are mapping 0 to two different values. And in the analogy of the math function here, what that means is that would be the same as if I mapped 1x to two different y values, right? And in math, we know that this is not allowed. So let's see what happens in Python. Well, it does not cause an error. However, 0 obviously maps to 3 now. So the order seems to be consistent. So 0 become 0, 1, 2 is still in order, but the value to which the key 0 is mapped is now 3. So the rule seems to be the first key is kept and the last value belonging to a key is mapped. This seems to be the rule. We will see if that is the case. But so what this slide shows is there are some issues that we have to that may occur. And in order to understand what we see here, we have to understand what's going on in memory. So here is a brief overview of what a so-called hash table is. And hash tables is the underlying data structure of how dictionaries are modeled in Python. However, I will go ahead and draw the dictionaries in the same way in our memory diagrams as always. So let's see. I will show you how one of the two simple examples of the dictionaries is modeled. So let's take the dictionary two words that maps the three integers to the three strings. How is that modeled in memory? So what Python does when we create a dictionary, it creates a box that technically is also an array, just like the list that we've seen many times before. But I have to draw this a little bit bigger to illustrate some points. And of course, whenever we draw such an array, it will be bigger than the number of elements that we want to put in. That because we already know that Python tries to make or must make some assumptions about how many elements go in, because we don't want to deal with the memory explicitly. That's why Python is a high-level language. So Python has to make some assumptions. And so what Python then does, so these are slots. Another word for slots would be bucket. This is why you see the word bucket here on the presentation. But the proper word would still be slot, I guess. And then what Python does, it draws another line of separation here. So we have now a grid, kind of. And then what Python does, the slots, they are labeled. And usually I wouldn't do that, but let's put indices here. So this would be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. And how many there are is not the issue here. It could be less, it could be more. This is an implementation detail, and we don't care about this. But what we care about is the following. And then up here, maybe I should write this as well, on the upper side, we will write the keys. And on the lower side, we will put the values. And then because Python always keeps track of what the type of an object is, we of course have the type dict here, because this is going to be a dictionary. And now I told you that I want to model the two words dictionary. So what's going to happen is we will have six objects inside this dict, three keys and three values. So the first key would be this, which is zero, and it's going to be an int. So what Python is doing, and I will just do it now as if I were the Python interpreter, and then we will look how what I'm about to show you works exactly later on. So Python does some calculation with that, which we will call hashing. So it will call the built-in hash function, and it will get back basically a number that helps it to map it into one of these buckets here. And the idea is that all the buckets are equally likely. That's the idea of the hashing algorithm. So let's say, for example, that Python decides to put this int into bucket number 4. So it puts in a reference here. This is just like any ordinary reference in a list. And now the zero number is in here. And then what happens is, if that worked, Python goes ahead and creates text string. And because this is the value corresponding to this key, Python will go here and put a reference here, okay? And now we do that two more times. So Python, the next object it will create will be the object 1. And this will be, of course, an int. And then Python goes ahead and via the hashing algorithm that I'm going to show you later, it figures out which of these slots it will put it in. And as I said, any slot is equally likely, so there is a chance that Python, for whatever reason, wants to put in the reference going to the 1 in the same slot as here. And whenever this happens, we have a name for that. We call that a hash collision. But let's assume Python wants to put it into the 1, maybe. So we get this reference here. So what happens next is Python will go ahead and, of course, create the string 1 and properly type it here. And then, of course, go ahead and make a reference go here. And then one last time, Python will go ahead and create here the true object, which is, of course, an int, and go through the same hashing algorithm again. And in the example now, maybe choose slot number 6 to put this in. And then in the last object that it needs to create to model this, it will create a new object, put the word 2 in it, we'll put str string here, and then we'll, of course, put the reference here. And then now the dictionary has been created. And now what happens, since everything on the right-hand side of the assignment statement was achieved, Python goes ahead and creates a name, in this case, two words, and makes the name in the global namespace reference the dictionary object. So this is what happens when we create a dictionary. So this thing here, we call a hash table. And what is a hash table? Well, at the end of the day, what this is, it basically means Python does exactly the same as for lists and for tuples, but for every slot, it just reserves twice the space. Why exactly twice? Well, as we've already learned before, Python in the lists and in the tuples only keeps the references, so the objects are never inside the array. They are always only references. And because of that, Python does not need or exactly needs twice the space as for a list here, right? And then it keeps the references, one reference to the key and the corresponding reference to the value that is mapped to it, and this is it. And then again, which slot we take, this happens by random chance in a way. It's actually not by random chance. Actually, it happens by a deterministic algorithm called the hash algorithm, but it appears as if it's happening by random chance. And the important thing is the hash algorithm has to sort in the references in a uniform way. So every slot has to be equally likely, otherwise the algorithm would not be good. But we don't want to go into too much details that you would study in the field of computer science. We will just, all we want is we want to get a rough understanding of what's going on in the computer's memory. And this is what happens when we create a dictionary. And now I want to show you the hash function. So Python's built-in hash function does the following. We give it an argument like 0. The string, and we get back some number. We have seen such long numbers before, and that was usually the kind of numbers that were returned by the ID function. However, this is not an ID. This is not a memory address. This is just a number that somehow deterministically gets calculated from whatever we give the hash function. So if I execute this function again, hopefully, I get the same number again. So yes. My computer is not broken, luckily, so I get the same hash number, the same hash value back. And then what does Python do? Python looks at this number, and then it looks at the number of slots it has reserved. And again, Python decides how big the dictionary is for us. So Python maybe decides, okay, this has now 9 slots or 8 slots or whatever. We don't care how many slots, but Python makes a decision how wide the array is. And then what Python does is it figures out a way of how to map this number exactly into one of those slots. And how does it do that? Well, without going into too much detail, it basically does modulo division. And what does modulo division do? Modulo division is division that gives you the rest that remains after the division. And let's say if you divide this big number here, the big number here, by the number of slots that we have, you will get a number between 0 and the number of the slots we have, right? Because if we modulo divide by something, or if we modulo divide by some number, the result will always be between 0 and 1 less than the number we divide by, right? Because the rest can never be more than the number we divide by. And that's so modulo division here again. I told you in chapter 1 that modulo division is basically a very powerful concept that we use all over the place in programming. And modulo division basically, conceptually at least, is what's going on when we map this long long integer number here into one of the slots. And now the question is, of course, how do we get from the value here from the string value from 0 to this number? Well, this is done by a hashing algorithm. And in order to understand that, we would really have to study computer science or do some reading on the web. It's not so hard, but this is really not important for us as pragmatic programmers here, because we only want to prepare ourselves for a practical data science career and not go into too much detail here in hashing algorithms, but it's quite interesting. So let's see what does the hash function do with other numbers. So some numbers, they seem to give you back an intuitive result. So whenever we pass in an integer to the hash function, we get back basically the number itself. However, if I pass in, let's say, 0.1, I get back some, you know, totally weird number. So that means just a small difference in the value going from 0 to 0.1 leads to a, you know, a big difference in the hash value, and that's on purpose, right? That's the whole idea of a hash algorithm. The whole idea is to basically, when deciding in which slot an object goes, and the only thing that determines where this goes is the value. So this zero here determines which of the slots this zero will go in, and also this two and this one here will determine in which slots they go. What you want is, you want, if you have different numbers, you want to have a very high chance that the slots in which they go are different. You don't want hash collisions. You don't want Python to, you know, put in a reference where there is a reference. Okay. And then maybe you wonder well, what happens if Python, if two objects are supposed to go inside the same slot. Well, then what Python does is, if Python, let's say, for example, decided that the one should go in here where the zero is, and then there is already a reference in it, what Python does is it conceptually, it's not the whole truth, but conceptually, it runs the hash algorithm again with a little bit of a different initial value so as to get a different slot back. So in other words, Python puts in the first reference into the array, and then once the second one goes, most likely it will not collide, because there's a very high chance it won't collide. But in the case, in the rare case that the second reference going in collides with the first one that is already somewhere in the array, then another slot will be chosen by the same hash algorithm. And then, of course, what we see already is the more references we already have inside the array, the higher is the chance that we get a hash algorithm, a hash collision. Sorry. So, and that means, in other words, the more crowded this array gets, the higher is the chance that we have a hash collision, and the higher the chance for a hash collision is, the more often the hash function needs to be run to find another slot. And in that regard, putting something into the dictionary will become slower. Okay, do you see that? So if you have to check several slots if they're empty before you put in the reference, that of course takes more time. And that means if this array gets too crowded, inserting in the dictionary will become slower, which is why there is a rule of thumb. If this hash table gets two-thirds full, what Python does, it will create a new hash table that is twice as big somewhere else in memory and will copy over all the references. And when the references go from the small hash table to the bigger hash table, what happens is they go through the same hashing algorithm again. And so they get a new bucket, right? So if the zero is in the fourth bucket here, and for whatever reason this dictionary gets too crowded, and we copy and we get a new dictionary, a new hash table, where we put in all the references, then most likely the zero will not be in the fourth spot in the new hash table. It will be in some other spot. Now, if you study computer science, you will have to learn a lot about hash tables and hashing. But again, this is abstracted away from us. But still, since we just saw one slide before, two slides before, we saw some weird behavior in Python. Namely, what we saw is that something couldn't be put inside the dictionary because it was unhashable. And then second, if we put in a key twice, then one gets lost. So we must be careful. And I want to show you, I want to explain to you why these two things happen. So let's first look at the second observation we made. The second observation we made is if we put in a zero, if we put in a zero twice, then the second zero will override the first zero. So let's try. So what happens? For example, if I try to calculate the hash value of the float 0.0, well, the hash value of 0.0, interestingly, is also zero. And maybe let's do one more thing. Let's create 0 plus 0j. So what does that do? That creates a complex number that is also equal to zero, basically. Let's check what is the hash value of this. And oh, it's also zero. So in other words, there is a rule. And the rule is if two objects compare equal, even if they have a different type, but as long as two objects, when they compare equal, when the semantic meaning of the value of the object is the same, then they get the same hash value. Okay? And this has to do with the fact that if we put in a zero inside the dictionary as the key, we want to be able to retrieve it, to look it up, not only with the integer zero, but also with the float 0.0. Should we ever do that? Probably not. But the fact is, if we later on work with dictionaries, we only want to really insert stuff and look up stuff by the semantic value, so to say. And in this regard, I mean value in the terms of the value of the object. Okay, so and that's for technical reasons here. So we now know if two objects evaluate equal, they will have the same hash value. And if you have the same hash value, you will end up in the same bucket. And then if, for example, I put in the zero here, where is it? The zero in this one here. And the corresponding value is the object with the string zero. If I then put in another zero with the key and it maps to some other string as the value, then whatever is put in last will overwrite what was put in first. Okay? So in other words, this reference will get overwritten, and that means we lose the value in this case. Okay, so we remember that means, I mean, what does it mean effectively? That means that the dictionary behaves as if it were a mathematical function, and just as we wrote here earlier, the axes have to be unique. Okay, this is why. It has to do with the way the hash table is implemented and the hash tables work. Okay, and now, from what I just said, follows the second observation. So what I just did is, I said, if two objects evaluate equal, they have to have the same hash value. In other words, the hash value seems to be dependent on the semantic value of an object. And because that is the case, that means if an object were able to change its semantic value throughout its lifetime, it would have a different hash value. And we know objects that can change their semantic value. What did we call these objects before? We called them mutable objects, like the list type, for example. So whenever an object allows us to change the ones and zeros inside it, that means its hash table is not unique. And if an object does not have a unique hash table, a unique hash value, then what that means is the bucket into which it goes is not unique as well. In other words, for a mutable object, we don't know in which slot to put it. And this also has to do with the fact that whatever we put inside the hash table, we want to be able to look it up later. That's the whole idea, as we shall see. The whole idea of a hash table is to look up things in a very fast way. That's the only reason really to use a hash table. And if we want to look something up that changed its value in the meantime, how do we look it up? Well, we can't. Because if it changes its value in the meantime, it also changes its hash value in the meantime. And if it's changed its hash value in the meantime, it also got a different bucket. That means we cannot find it anymore. That means the hash table would work as if it were a black hole. We would put something in, and we couldn't find it anymore. That is why we cannot put in mutable objects. So here is the example. I try to calculate the hash value of a list. And this is why I get back the type error. And the hash function complains that the object we put in is of a mutable type. That's the problem here. Unfortunately, the error message here is not so nice. It doesn't really, I mean, it basically says the type we gave it is unhashable. But, well, I mean, it's actually quite funny. We call it the hash function, and we get an error, and it says the object is unhashable. So what do we learn from this? Nothing. So the error message would be a little bit nicer if it said, type error, the object is mutable, and it must be immutable. And but now we have learned this. So now you know you can only put immutable objects as a key inside the hash table or inside the dictionary. So how do we make the list immutable? We have learned that in the first part of chapter 7. Instead of a list, the brackets, we just use a tuple with a parentheses. So here the brackets, and down here we have the parentheses. So that's now a tuple. And we know that a tuple is nothing but a list that is immutable. In other words, the tuple will look somewhat similar like the dictionary, just with only one, let's say with only the upper half of the array. And once a reference is inside the tuple, it cannot be changed. And because of that, a tuple has a hash value. And because of that, I can put in, or I can use a tuple as a key in the dictionary. Let's execute the next line. And what we see also is, so now I have as a key, I have the tuple, so an immutable object. And on the right-hand side, this is mapped to a list. So the value within a dictionary does not have to be immutable. And that's okay, because when we want to look something up, we always look it up by the key. We never look up the value by value, right? So, and because of that, the value can be mutable or immutable. We don't care. So the learning here is, whenever we want to use a, let's call it a composite key, a key in a dictionary that is composed of more than one object, then we must use a tuple to collect them together. And then also, all the objects within the tuple must also be immutable. So the entire left-hand side that is used as a key must be immutable. Okay. Okay, so now I think we have analyzed all of what we need to understand about hash tables, so that now we know how the dictionary type works. And now let's look a little bit about how they behave. So in chapter 7, in the beginning, we talked about the four properties of a sequence in abstract terms. And in this section, back then, I said that three of those properties, when they come together in a type, then the type is called a collection. And only the fourth property, if it also applies, the type is called a sequence. So let's go over the four properties again. And let's go over the first three ones that constitute a collection, and then add the fourth one to get to the sequence that we already know. So the first property that is important, it has to be a container, right? I mean, that makes sense. If we look at the name collection, you know, a collection seems to, you know, be a collection of some other things. So a collection is always a container, like a list, for example. A list is also a container. However, a dictionary is also a container. Why? Because obviously, the dictionary contains references to other objects. So that's the first property. The second property was that it has a finite length or a finite number of elements. We called this formally sized. And we see, of course, that the dictionary is also finite, right? The hash table is finite. Of course, if we put in more stuff, we will, as I said, get a new hash table that is twice as big, but even the twice as big hash table is finite. So dictionaries are finite. And then what is the third property? Well, it's called the iterable, so we can loop over it. And now, when we said that we want to be able to loop over something, we also said that looping does not necessarily have to occur in an order that we can predict. I mean, if we loop over something, naturally there is a looping order, right? But we cannot predict the order. And however, for sequences, we could. So note, the fourth property, which we formally called reversible or reversibility, this means that we can predict an order, because if something is reversible, there is a forward order. However, dictionaries don't have a predictable order. So let me summarize. We have four properties, three of which make up a collection. The three that make up a collection, as the collection as a concept, are the container property, the size property, and the iterable property. And then the fourth property, which is reversible, only holds true for sequence types. And again, the term collection is to be used just as we use the term sequence. And mappings from, let's say, X's to Y's are just collections without an order. So they basically have all the behavior that a sequence has, just anything that relies on the order, on a predictable order, is not not given. So let's look at the concrete examples here. So I can, for example, ask the dictionary, hey, how many elements do you have? Now I get three. So what did we put into from words? So let's look at from words again. So we have 0 is mapped to 0, 1 is mapped to 1, and 2 is mapped to 2. So obviously, it's the number of mappings that is relevant here, right? It's not the number of things in it, because there are 6 objects inside from words. But when we call len, then we get 3. And now maybe let me introduce another word. I said that the things that are mapped, the axes, we call them the keys, and the things to which they are mapped, we call them the values. If we look at them together, so if we look at a key value pair, then we call that formally an item. Unfortunately, some people in the Python world don't use the word item so strictly as I do. So oftentimes the word item is confused with the term element. And the term element is actually what we use when we go over a sequence. So the members of a sequence, so to say, or the objects inside a sequence, we call them elements. And the items inside a collection or inside a mapping, that's what we call an item. But it's not so important, these type of words here. So again, but just to summarize, the number of things inside a dictionary is equal to the number of items, which is equal to the number of key value pairs. We can loop over dictionaries. And that's interesting because I just said dictionaries don't have an order. So let's loop over them. And what do we loop over? I said for word in from word. So from words is the dictionary that maps the English words to the integers. And obviously, if I loop over from words, I seem to be getting out the keys, right? So these are the keys inside the dictionary. And that's the default behavior. When I loop over a dictionary, I loop over its keys. I totally disregard the values. In other words, I go over the upper half of the array. Now, what is the order? I just told you that there is no order. That was not the full truth. So there is, of course, an order, because as we said, in a computer, nothing is random. Everything is deterministic. So what is the order here? Well, I tell you the order. The first object we put inside will get the index 1. The second object we get inside will get the index 1 here, 0, 1. And then the last object we put in will get the index 2. So what Python does, and this is only true starting with, I think, Python 3.6, and, but it's definitely true for Python 3.7, which is the one that we are using currently. The dictionaries remember an order. And what order do they remember? They remember the insertion order. So that's when. So in other words, when we loop over a dictionary, we get to the keys in the dictionary in insertion order, right? So it's not here the index of the slot that counts, but it's the index that we remember somehow magically in which we inserted the objects. And this is only true in the last, as I said, in starting version 3.6. And there is a nice talk that I have in the further resources section by Raymond Hettinger, who is a Python core developer, and he's also a very entertaining guy. He also has many, many good talks. that you can listen to study Python in detail. And he actually has a 60-minute talk where he only talks about how dictionaries work internally, which basically starts where I just left off here by explaining to you what the how the hash table works. And in a way, hash tables as a theory are quite old. I think they were invented sometime in the 60s or something. But then the Python people actually, so for a long time, everyone thought that we as mankind, we know everything about hash tables. But then a couple of years ago, some very smart Python core developers figured out that, hey, we can also kind of store an order here. And they suggested that, and they implemented that. And now dictionaries remember the insertion order. And yeah, it's a good talk, and it's very much in detail. And I think that's a level of detail that, as a data science practitioner, we would not need, but it's still interesting to know. So let's go on. Can I go over? Can I loop over a dictionary in reverse order? Let's try. And I can't. And this means, and we get now the nice error message: dict object is not reversible. And that's the fourth property that sequences have and that collections don't have. Or collections, I mean, collections is the more generic thing. So a collection may be reversible, but if a collection is reversible, it's a sequence. And a collection that is not reversible is not a sequence. And the dict type is a collection that is not ordered. And that's how we see it. We cannot reverse it. I mean, by now you understand why. In all the previous chapters, whenever I talked about these four properties, I always used the reversed built-in to reverse over the text, over, I don't know, we basically reversed all the types that we introduced. But for all the types, it worked. But now we see the first data type for which it doesn't work. And now you may wonder, why would I ever need a data type? Or would I actually use a data type at all? If it's not ordered, because I mean, if I can use the list or the tuple, I have an order for free, basically. But the thing is, if you want to model order in a data type, this does not come for free, as we shall see. And then the fourth property is the container property, and so we can check if a key is in the dictionary. So we check is one in from words, and the answer is true. And if I check, for example, the German word eins, this is, of course, false. And I don't get an error. So it's the in operator at work here who checks if the operand on the left-hand side is included in the dictionary in this case. And all that happens, all that means for a dictionary is Python goes ahead and it checks if somewhere in the upper half, in the key part of the hash table, we will find this a reference that goes to this object. And let me take the chance of how does the key lookup work. So how does the in operator work? Well, the in operator is very smart, because now there are two ways. There are two ways of how we can do searching now, or looking up here in the keys area. So one way would be we start at the left and we walk through it, and whenever we hit a reference, we follow the reference and check is the thing we are looking for equal to this. Now this would be very very stupid, right? If we go from left to right, we would the search would take quite some time, and that's actually a pattern that we called a linear search. I think I introduced this word at first in chapter 4. So linear search means we go from beginning to end and we check if what we're looking for is equal to the thing we are value of the object at which position we are at the moment. So we go in the worst case scenario from beginning to end without finding it. However, in a dictionary, the in operator works differently. In a dictionary, the in operator is so smart that it takes the operand on the left-hand side, eins, and puts it into the hash function that we saw, calculates the hash value, and then knows immediately in which bucket it has to be. And then it just goes to the bucket and checks, is it in there? And in this case, so let me go back. Let's do the original example of one. So one is, of course, in the dictionary. So what it does, what Python here does is it calculates the hash value of 1, and the hash value of 1 happens to be a number that would be sorted into the first slot. And then Python goes directly to the slot number 1 and sees, oh, there is a reference. So it follows the reference, because there can only be one place, and it compares it for equality. And then if it's equal, then it says true. So search, looking up 1 here, or membership testing, the in operator is also called membership testing, works super fast, because there is only one slot at which the word can actually be stored. And then, of course, if I do, let's say, the German word eins, what happens is the German word eins goes through the hash function. We get a hash value back, and then with the hash value, we determine the slot into which it should go. And then there are two possibilities. First, let's say eins should be stored in, let's say, bucket 0. And then Python goes there and sees there is no reference. And then it immediately returns false, because it knows, OK, there is nothing in it, and the German word eins can only be in this slot. It cannot be somewhere else. The second possibility is that it also gets back a number, let's say, for example, 2, let's say the number 6. So it looks up some slot where there is something in it. So all Python has to do now is follow this one reference and compare this value with the value eins, and this will be different. And because it will be different, it will then, of course, also say false. So in other words, looking up something with the in operator in a dictionary is always fast, because it will cost us at most one reference following. So we always determine the bucket and follow the reference if it's there, and then we know if the object is in the dictionary or not. And also, just note here in the example in the code, I'm looking at the from words dictionary, and here I drew the to words dictionary, so it's just vice versa, but don't be confused here. You get the idea. Okay. And this is something that we don't have with lists. So searching in lists is slow. Searching in lists means we have to do a linear search, and searching in a dictionary means we can do the hash table lookup, and the hash table lookup is super fast. Okay, and actually, I have a section on that, membership testing, lists versus dictionary, on exactly that topic. So let's do a little simulation just to illustrate to you how much faster. So I import the random module, and let's create a needle and a haystack. So the needle is, of course, 42. And how do we create the haystack? Well, the haystack has to be big. So I use a list comprehension, and I loop over range with a very large number, 10 million. And then 10 million times, I draw a random integer between 99 and 9,999. And then once I created this list, I append the needle to this list, OK? Let's do that. This will take a little bit, because this is a huge list with 10 million numbers in it. Hopefully, my computer won't die, and it's still creating the list. And then now the list is created. And now let's see. The list is, of course, unordered, right? We know exactly where the needle is, right? The needle is at the end, because I appended the needle. So now what I do is I use the shuffle function in the random module and pass it the haystack. And the shuffle function in the random module, what it does is, it has no return value. We see that. I don't even try to capture anything. So what the shuffle function in the random module does, it takes any sequence and reorders the elements in the sequence. So if you read the documentation on the shuffle function, you will see that it does not require a list, for example. It only requires a sequence. So it only requires the four behaviors that we always talk about. And so now if I call random.shuffle with the haystack, then the haystack now gets mixed. And now the needle is somewhere else in the haystack, and we have to look for it. So let's just see. Let's look at the first 10 numbers. The first 10 numbers are just random integers. And let's also confirm that the needle is not at the end. So let's look at the last 10 numbers in the haystack, and that the needle is also not at the end. So the needle is now somewhere in the haystack, and we have to find it. So how can we do that now that we have a list? So the haystack is modeled as a list. So what we do is we just do the following. Here, I loop over. So what I do here is I here's the following. What I just mark is the important part. I only call the in operator. So I call needle in haystack, and what needle in haystack will do is it will let me maybe also just to compare this put an ordinary list up here. And this would be the haystack. And now, of course, there is a lot of stuff inside the haystack. And now what the linear search will do, Python will, of course, go to the first slot in the list and initiate the linear search. So it will compare the first element to 42, and probably it will be no. Then it will go on. Compare the second one to the 42, and probably it will go on. And then somewhere, probably somewhere in the middle of the haystack, and the haystack is quite big, it will find the 42, it will find the needle, and then what Python will do, it will short circuit out of it. And then that takes some time. Why does it take some time? Well, I have to make lots of comparisons to find the needle. This is like a brute force search in a way. So, and in order to see the timing differences, I do that 10 times. So I run a linear search 10 times just to see the timing a little bit, to make it a bit more apparent what the timing is. So now this cell runs, and I have the time it magic there, and it took about almost 5 seconds. That means, because I ran the simulation 10 times, searching for the needle in the haystack took on average half a second. And now, let's do the following. I use the dict constructor, and I create a dictionary from the haystack. And note how what we learned in the last chapter fits seamlessly here. This is a generator expression, so I don't create an unnecessary list that is in memory and will get lost anyways. So I just write a generator expression. And the generator expression loops over the haystack. And for every x in the haystack, I have to return a tuple, and the tuple has its first element, the x, and the second element will be none. And this is a dummy value, because the dictionary, of course, needs to have a key and a value, but we only model numbers, so we don't need the values. So I put a dummy value in here, and the dummy value would be none. And then I store the dictionary under the variable magic haystack. And magic, why is it magic? Well, because it's a dictionary. And now this is created. And now I do the same thing again. I am looking for the needle in the magic haystack. However, note one thing. I'm running this cell 10 million times. Okay, so 10 million times I initiate a search. And let's see how fast the cell is as a whole. It's 600 milliseconds. Wow, that's just half a second. But in what did we do in this half a second? In half a second, we did one linear search. That was the upper cell. In the same half a second, we did 10 million searches with the magic haystack. So in other words, looking up or searching for something in the dictionary is 10 million times faster than searching for something in a list. Okay? So what do we learn from this? We learn from this that whenever we do need to model an order, we cannot use the dictionary. In these situations, we have to use, let's say, a list or maybe a tuple. However, whenever we have to use a list or a tuple, we lose something. We have to pay a price. And what's the price we pay? The price we pay is we don't have a hash table. And by not having a hash table, means looking up keys takes forever. In other words, we have a trade-off here. We have a trade-off between having an order, modeling a predictable order, which sometimes is necessary, and looking up something in a very fast way. So that's a trade-off, and we cannot do anything about this. We have to choose one or the other. And as a data scientist, depending on what problem you are working on and what data you are given, you will choose either a list or a dictionary or something else. Of course, there are other types as well that are even more advanced than what we learn in this course. But what we see here is it really pays off to study the various data types in Python in detail, because once we understand them in detail, we can make better choices when modeling a problem in code. Okay, so that's the trade-off. And how did we get this speed? Well, what is the price we pay? What is the price we pay for the speed? The price is that we have to have, in as of now at least, we will see towards the end of the chapter that I can also mitigate this, but as of now, I have to pay the price that I need twice the memory because I need keys and values. And also note that we have lots and lots of empty slots in a dictionary. So a dictionary is always wasteful. And the dictionary is wasteful on purpose, because if the dictionary were not wasteful with the memory, the hashing wouldn't work. And if the hashing doesn't work, then we don't get the speed. So we lose two directions. We lose space here. The first one is that we have, you know, a second dimension, so to say, and the first one is all the emptiness. And maybe to introduce another technical term here, data structures that don't have spaces in it quite often, like the list here, we call them dense. And then we have data structures that have lots of empty slots in it, and we call them sparse. So that's two technical words of how to analyze the memory in a computer. And again, here we trade off memory against runtime. So by having more memory, by using more memory, we get better runtime. And these days, because memory has become very cheap, oftentimes that's a good trade-off, because you know, buying just more RAM is not so costly anymore. Okay, and the second problem, the problem that we have keys and values, we will see there is something called a set data type towards the end of this chapter, and this means we will get rid of the values here, so we can mitigate this problem. So let's see what we can do with indexing, or what we can do with dictionaries. Namely, we can do indexing, but we don't call it indexing. We call it dict lookup or key lookup. So the syntax here is what we know from lists. So this is the indexing operator, the brackets. But now in the from words dictionary, I want to look up two. So let's look it up, and I get back the integer two. So that's not really rocket science here. The only thing that you need to understand is we use the indexing operator as before, but instead of putting in an integer, we put in oftentimes something else, for example, a text string. Of course, if we map integers to words, just like we did in the two words example, then of course we would also be able to write a zero here, right? So let me just show you. If I write two words, we can of course index with zero and get back the string zero. And now, if we look at what we see here, just by reading this, two words index zero, we cannot, I repeat it, we cannot tell what data type this is. We don't know if this is a list, a tuple, or a dictionary. And that's what we mean when we say in Python only the behavior matters. So all of these data types that I just mentioned have in common that we can index into them. And depending on what content they have, we index into them with integers. Okay, so let's go back here. Old example. And then what happens if I try to look something up that is not in it? So if I try to look up the German word drei for three, I get a key error because I don't find the key. And this is analog to what happens in the case of a list or a tuple. In the case of a list or a tuple, I will get an index error if the index is out of range. And here I just get a key error, but a key error and an index error is really the same. Now, what can we do with that? Let's go back to our people example. So remember that people is just a list, it's three lists of people. And let's see, I only want to look at the mathematicians. How do I do that? Well, I just look up people, index operator, and then I write the string mathematicians, and then I only have the two mathematicians, Euler and Gilbert Strang. Okay, and now let's say I want to look at an individual mathematician on the list. How do I do that? Well, what did I just get back? By indexing into the dictionary, I get back a list, right? Here, we get back a list of dictionaries. So what we can do is, we can, of course, index, let's say, with the zero. And now we get back the first mathematician, which is Gilbert Strang. Now, the list is, of course, ordered, so zero will always be the same. So now, so now I'm looking at Gilbert Strang. So now, and what do I get back now? I get back a dictionary. I see that because of the curly braces here. Curly braces and the colons here, which lists the items. So this is obviously a dictionary. And let's say I want to index into the dictionary. How can I do that? Well, I can chain another indexing operator. And let's say I want to look up the name of the first mathematician. This would be just a string, Gilbert Strang. And when you get data from a web API, then often you will do this. You will often reach deep into the data structure to get something out of the data structure that you want to work with. And of course, I can also look at the email addresses that Gilbert has. And this is a list that contains one string, which is his email address. Okay. Next topic, mutability. Mutability means I can change an object after it was created in memory. Dictionaries are mutable. So let's look at the example, two words. So I have the integer 012 mapped to the strings 012. Let's say I want to change it. For example, I want to translate it to German. How do I do that? Several ways, but one way is I just use the indexing operator on the left-hand side, and I assign to it. I assign to an index, and I just assign to it a string with the string I want to have. So let's execute this. And this will override what is in a dictionary. So now, 012 is mapped to the German words 012. And why does it override? Well, if I try to insert something with the same key that is already inside the dictionary, then writing into will just, it will look up the same key, and then at its corresponding value reference, this will be deleted and will be replaced with a reference to the new object that we create. Okay, so that's it. We learned that we can, the access have to be unique. So that's why we overwrite them here. And in the same way, I can do something that does not work with lists. I can basically add new items to the dictionary. So let's add the numbers 3 and 4, 3 und 4 in German. And now we have 5 numbers in the dictionary. So we cannot only overwrite items, we can also add new items. And of course, we can also get rid of them. How do we do that? We use a del statement. So we del two words and then index 0, but it's not the index, it's the key 0 actually. And I execute this, and now the two words dictionary has no 0 in it. So let's play a little bit with the example of the people list. So note that if I look at people, I don't have a physicist, so I want to put in the physicist, right? It's a proud species, the physicist, so let's have one. And how do we do that? Well, if I look at physicists, I get back an empty list. And now if I want to change the list in place, how can I do that? I can call, for example, a method on it, in this case, append. And what do I append to the list? I append to it a new dictionary with the name Albert Einstein. Note how I use a dictionary to model a person, but so far, all the dictionaries we have seen in the people dictionary that model people, they always have a name and emails. And here I just put in Albert Einstein, who only has a name. But it's okay. He can live. Albert Einstein, I mean, he doesn't live anymore. So in a way, he can live without an email address. And of course, I can change stuff. So for example, if I go into people's programmer, in the programmer's list inside people, I have it gives me back a list, and it contains only one dictionary. In order to obtain it, I index into the list now with zero. Now I have now I get back a dictionary, and now I want to look at only the name of this person. And the name is of course Guido. And let's say I just want to give Guido also his last name. I can just override it. And now I changed it. And maybe one more time. Regarding Guido van Rossum. So let's maybe use the upper cell to change that. So Guido van Rossum has two email addresses. But unfortunately, last year he retired from Dropbox. So let's just delete his Dropbox email. We can, of course, also use a delete statement and delete something within the nested data structure. It's also possible. And now if I print out the people again, now I have Albert Einstein in it without an email. And Guido has only one email address. And he also has his last name. So this is how we wrangle with data in memory. So now, just as we looked at list methods and tuple methods and what else, all kinds of methods in the last couple of chapters, we also look at the dictionary methods. String methods we have also seen before, of course. So what are some typical dictionary methods? For example, keys. So what does .keys allow us? Well, it allows us to, for example, loop over the keys. Now, you may wonder, do we really need it? Well, couldn't I just loop over the dictionary and that automatically loops over the keys? Well, it does, but by saying .keys, that allows us to be a bit more explicit here. And we learned from the Zen of Python that explicit is better than implicit. And then, of course, what is keys? Well, this is a special type that is returned, which basically means I get a few inside the keys of the dictionary. And this is an optimization in Python 3. I can look at only the keys inside a dictionary and without copying them. This is what the .keys method really does. So .keys gives me a way to look at the keys inside a dictionary without, you know, making a copy and without changing anything. It's just a way to look into the keys. Now, if I want to loop over the values, I just say .values. And same as with .keys, .values just gives me back a few inside the dictionary, and I only look at the values. And of course, to complete the picture, I have a method called .items, which allows me to loop over the pairs, to the key value pairs. Also works, and items is, of course, also a few inside the dictionary. This gives me back all the items as a tuple, in case I wanted to loop over it, but not so important here. But you get the point. And then let's see what other methods we have. Well, there is two words. That's what it looks like. We can two words does not have a zero in it. And we saw basically what that means. If I try to look up zero, I get a key error because key is not in two words anymore. However, if I still want to look up an element, or a key, and I'm not sure if the key is in there, I can use the .get method. And the .get method takes as its first argument the key I want to look up, and the second argument is a default value. And in the case that I don't find the key in the dictionary, the default argument gets returned, so not available here. And of course, if I try to get, let's say, a key that is inside a dictionary, then, like, for example, the one, then I get back eins because it's in it, okay? So get is kind of like indexing just without the error messages. And then let's see two words. What else can we do? Okay, we have two words, which is the integers 1 to 4 mapped to German words. And now I have a second dictionary to Spanish, which maps the numbers 1 through 5 to Spanish numbers, Spanish words. And now I can say two words dot update, and I pass it to Spanish. And what happens is, I don't get a return value here. That's important. And we know already what that means. If I call a method on an object and I don't get a return value, most likely this means that something was changed in place, right? So let's look at two words. And indeed, all the Spanish words were did actually override the German words. And also the 5, the 5, is now also in the dictionary. However, two words is still the same dictionary object. So the object never changed. The object, we only created one object, one object in memory, and we only played with the contents of it. So if we look at from words, of course, what can we do here? We can use .pop, and then we give .pop a key, like 0. And what it does, it pops off the value. And what popping off means, number is now, we capture it, so we get the 0, but also the 0 is now gone from the dictionary. It's just like pop in a for a list, but the pop for a list also works without an argument. And here, the pop really needs an argument because there is no obvious or no predictable order, which means we have to tell .pop what to pop off the dictionary. And in the same way, there is a function called popItem, and popItem is kind of like, it's more like the .pop that a list type comes with. It just takes a random item and pops it off. Of course, nothing is random but in a computer, but the point that I want to make here is, because there is no predictable order in a list, we don't know, we cannot predict which item will be returned. And of course, if we look at from words now, 2 and 2, the tuple here was indeed removed. So pop item means to also not only get it back, but also remove it. Okay, and now comes a nice section. We will look one more time at packing and unpacking. So we have looked at packing and unpacking before in the section on tuples. And when did we use, or among others, there was also a list unpacking and so on. But now we list in this what is in this section here. We look at, we will look at, we will quickly review also packing and unpacking for tuples, and also add packing and unpacking for dictionaries. And then we will put it together into one bigger picture, which allows us to understand how to write functions in with arguments or parameters in any way we want. So let's see. So let's create a new two words dictionary in with the English words again. And then there is a second dictionary called more words, and this is also English. And then note how the integer 2 is mapped to 2 in uppercase, and this is just to illustrate a point, because the 2 in lowercase is already in the first dictionary, and now we create a second dictionary, more words, with a second with a value 2 in uppercase. So just to illustrate the point. Now, let's say, and this is often a use case you have. Let's say you are given two dictionaries, and you want to create, so to say, the union of them. You want to take the items from both dictionaries and put them into one new dictionary, but you know that there is some overlap. And so there shouldn't, and we know by now that there cannot be two keys with the same object with the same value. So, in other words, something has to happen with the two here. So let's see how we can unpack the items of the two dictionaries into a new dictionary. Well, we can use the unpacking operator, but now because we work with dictionaries, we use the double asterisk. So a single asterisk unpacks a list or a tuple. And we've also seen the single asterisk to unpack a generator, for example. But now we use the double asterisk to unpack a dictionary. And this kind of makes sense, because when we unpack a dictionary, we will unpack key value pairs. So we have to do something for two objects at a time. So what happens if I execute this? I get a new dictionary. Now let's look at what items it has. It has the 0 from the first. It has the 1 also from the first. The 2 it has from the second one. This is the first item from the second dictionary. And then the 3 and the 4 are also there. So this is kind of like the union of all the items. And the one that goes last here in this syntax, this is the one that wins. Because the second one, the key two in the more words example, in the more words dictionary, overrides 2 in the first dictionary. But this unpacking syntax is really nice. So you often do that when you pass values around that actually you want to put inside a function call or something. You will see that often when you read more Python code. And now let's look at what that means in terms of function definitions and how we call functions. And this is now the final section or the final thing I say about how we can specify functions. So here's an example function called printArgs. And all it does, we give it our arguments, and all it does, it prints them out. It prints out all the arguments we give it. And we have seen a function called product taking a star and args, a star args before, in the end of the first part of chapter 7. And now what we see here is we've specified the function by giving it two parameters, args and quarks. So args are usually the so-called positional arguments, and the quarks are the so-called keyword arguments. And then we have here the asterisk. What does the asterisk mean here? Let me tell you, it has a different meaning than we have seen the double asterisk before. So on the slide before, the asterisks were there for unpacking. So we unpacked the items of existing dictionaries into a new dictionary. But what does the star do here and the double star? Well, what they do, now they do packing. So whatever, whatever I pass into this function when I call it gets packed into one of the two parameters. And now the rule is, if I call the function with positional arguments, the positional arguments get collected inside the args. And if I call the function with keyword arguments, the keyword arguments are collected inside a, and now you guess it correctly, a dictionary. Because that's what the keywords are. The keywords are really the names by which we pass in an argument to a function. So when we use keyword arguments, we can think of it as pairs. And we cannot call a function and specify the same keyword several times. Doesn't make sense, because what should the function do? It only can specify a parameter once. And then what do we do inside the function? Well, args is going to be a tuple. And because of that, we enumerate the tuple. So the enumerate built-in gives us back indices for free. And then we loop over the args for i, arg in args. And we just print out it's a position. And then we print out the index. And then we print out the individual arg. And then we do the same thing for the keyword arguments. And what do we use here? For quark, because I told you that quark is going to be a dictionary, we call the dictionary's items method, and we loop over the items, so over the key value pairs, and then we print out the word keyword and the key value. So let's see how this function works in action. So that means print args, number one, I can call it without arguments. This should work. It does not do anything. Well, what should it do? I mean, we defined it to print out arguments, but we did not pass it any arguments, so it doesn't print anything out. So next, I call it with three positional arguments, A, B, C. And what does it do? It prints out at position 0, I passed in A. At position 1, I passed in B. And at position 2, I passed in C. So that's positional arguments. What happens if I call the function with keyword arguments? Well, I pass in first equals 1, second equals 2, and third equals 3. What happens? Now, the function says the keyword first is mapped to 1, the keyword second is mapped to 2, and the keyword third is mapped to 3. And because of what I'm saying, because a keyword is always mapped to an argument, it makes sense to use a mapping type. And the most common mapping type is the dict type. And now we can, of course, mix them. So in this example, I call the function with two positional arguments and then one keyword argument, and then I get back this output. Okay, so by adding the asterisk and the double asterisk to pack together the positional arguments into a tuple and the keyword arguments into a dictionary, I make the function usable in many, many different ways. Of course, you have to know what you're doing, and you shouldn't do that if you don't need the arguments. But you are extremely flexible in Python in the way you define your functions, and then also in the way the function can be used, because the function is obviously used here in three different and four different ways. It even works without arguments. Okay, and now the second version of this is the final one, and this now shows everything about function definitions that you need to know. So what is different here? Well, first, I specify a positional parameter, and I don't give it a default value. And then I specify star args, and then I define another parameter with a name, and then I define quarks. So how does this read? Well, this reads as such. The first positional argument I have to provide. The function cannot live without it. Why? Because there is no default value. So I must pass in at least one positional argument. And what happens if I pass in more than one positional argument? All the additional positional arguments will be collected inside a tuple called args. And then we are not done yet. So what does that also mean? So the required key means I have to provide one argument by keyword at the very least, and this argument also must go by the name required name by required key. So in other words, this required key parameter here is also a keyword only argument. Remember the keyword only arguments? These are all the arguments that back in chapter 2 we specified to be the arguments that come after a single asterisk. Okay, so that's why, so these arguments I have to pass in by name. The only thing that was different in chapter 2 is, in chapter 2, these arguments, we use them, for example, for the scalar in the average evens example. So in chapter 2, we gave this keyword only argument a default value. Here we don't have a default value. Because of that, I have to pass it in. And then, of course, this is syntactically exactly the same. So once I have a single asterisk somewhere in my parameter list here, any argument that comes after it must be specified by name explicitly. It's a keyword-only argument. I cannot pass it without a keyword. And then all of the additional keywords, they are collected in a dictionary called quarks. And then in the body of the function, I print all of the four out individually. And of course, args and quarks, I can loop over. I can have possibly more than one. So I have to put the print inside a loop. So let's check how this function works. So can I still call the function without an argument? Well, the answer is, of course, no, because the positional argument is missing. Let's call the function with one positional argument and one keyword argument. Now it works. This is the very minimum I have to provide, otherwise the function won't run. And now I can, of course, go ahead and put in as many positional arguments as I want, and I can also put in as many keyword arguments as I want, okay? And now, okay, we call this the mandatory one, the required one. These are the optional positional arguments, and so on. And remember that once we are back here, once we start with the first keyword argument, there must be no further positional arguments. So once we see the first keyword argument, all the other arguments must pass in by keyword as well. Okay. Now let's have a very small topic here, dictionary comprehensions. This is very easy. This is kind of like the list comprehensions just for dictionaries. So let's assume I have my two words example again, the dictionary mapping integers to strings. And now I want to reverse it to the from words dictionary. How could I do that? Well, here's a first naive way. I first initialize an empty dictionary, and then I loop over all the items in the two words dictionary. And what I do then is I put the number and the word over which I loop into the from words dictionary in reverse order. So I whatever was the key first now becomes the value, and what was the value first becomes the key. I just reverse keys and values. In other words, this is inverting a function. That's what I'm doing here. So let's do that. Of course it works. Now I map the strings to the numbers. How can I make this in a conciser way? By using a dictionary comprehension. How does it work? Just like a list comprehension, I just write curly braces, and then inside it, in the beginning, I write the expression, the key value pair that I want to remain. So in this case, and then I write a for because I want to loop. And I could also add an if, actually, in the chapter. If you read it, you will also see that I can add additional functionalities. I can also have several loops and so on. This is just a simplistic example. So I loop over the two words items. I loop over them as key value pairs, and I store them as value key pairs. That's it. And if I evaluate this expression, I also get a new dictionary that is derived out of the existing dictionary. And that's the point. So just as we used a list comprehension to derive lists out of existing lists, we use a dict comprehension to derive new dictionaries out of existing dictionaries. But it's a very nice syntax, and this it's also a little bit faster because we know that for looping is a little bit inefficient. And also, of course, memory-wise, if, let's say, the for loop is quite long here, then Python may initialize the hash table in a too small way in the beginning. And then Python has to do all the copying and create bigger hash tables and so on. So it makes sense to just go over this here, and that's faster and looks nicer. So now the question is, I want to show you one application of dictionaries. So what can we use dictionaries for? Remember in chapter 4, we talked about the Fibonacci numbers, and we talked about recursion, and we observed how solving the Fibonacci numbers in a backwards fashion was extremely inefficient. And now I show you how we can solve the Fibonacci numbers in a backwards fashion in an efficient way. So, Fibonacci numbers revisited. That was the problem. In order to calculate the Fibonacci number for, let's say, index 5, I have to create, I have to calculate the Fibonacci number for index 4, and this requires me to calculate for index 3 and 2. But in order to calculate Fibonacci of 5, I also need to calculate the Fibonacci of 3, so we have repeating function calls. And this is an example of exponential growth. I don't want to talk too much about this here. If you want to look it up, go back to chapter 4. We covered this in detail. And the problem was that we calculate the same function call over and over and over again. So what is a solution? The solution we had in chapter 4 was we calculated the Fibonacci number with a for loop from beginning to end. But now what we do here is we still calculate the Fibonacci number from backwards to forwards, from end to start. And we do it in a way that is still efficient. How can we do that? Well, let's do this. Let's initialize a global dictionary called memo, in which the 0 and the 1 are mapped to 0 and the 1. What are these numbers? These are the first two Fibonacci numbers. So maybe real quick, the first two Fibonacci numbers, they are defined as 0 and 1, and the next Fibonacci number is just a sum, so this would be 1, and then the next Fibonacci number would be 1 plus 1 is 2, and next would be 1 plus 2 is 3, and the next would be 2 plus 3 is 5, and so on. But the first two, remember, by definition. And because they are like this by definition, we put them into the memo. And what's a memo? A memo is a thing where we can look up things real quick. So what do we want to look up? We want to look up on the left-hand side as key. We want to look up the index for which we want to calculate the Fibonacci function. And on the right-hand side as the value, we will have the solution to calculating the Fibonacci number with the index coming from the left side. So in this case, it wouldn't make a difference if we messed it up, but we have to know what we have to map from where to where. And also note, it is essential here, it is absolutely essential here, that the memo allows us to look up keys in what is called constant time. And how does that work? Well, just as any dictionary that is based on a hash table, whenever I want to look up a key, all that is done is Python takes the key, puts it into the hash function, gets a hash value, and then after getting the hash value, it calculates a bucket, and then it just has to look up, it just has to look into one bucket, and if nothing is in the bucket, if the bucket is empty, then we know that we have not, we don't have this in the hash table anywhere else. It can only be in one position, and this is essential. If we don't have this property, the speedy lookup in a hash table, then everything I'm about to show you wouldn't work. But now let's create this memo. That's where the idea, where the technical term memoization comes from. So memoization basically means we calculate something, we store it away, and whenever we need it, we just look it up. And so so let's look at the Fibonacci function one more time. So Fibonacci takes an index I as the argument. The debug on the right-hand side, ignore it. I just built it in to have some intermediate output. And you can look at this in detail when you read the chapter. Then we have some type checking going on. We don't check if I is an int object, but we just check if it behaves like an integral. So this is called goose typing in chapter 5. At the end of chapter 5, we talked about that. And then after we do the type checking, we do the input validation. So Fibonacci's, since the I is an index, it cannot be negative. And then we do the following. Our new Fibonacci function does the following. At first, before it does any calculations, it looks up if we have sometime before already calculated Fibonacci for I. And if we have so, we have stored it in memo. That's the assumption. So we look with the in operator, membership testing, we look if the index I is in the memo as a key. And if it is, we just return its value. And remember that the value to which we map the index is just the result of the Fibonacci function, which is a Fibonacci number. Okay? So that means before we do anything in this function, we check if we have already calculated Fibonacci for this particular argument before. And if we have so, we don't calculate it. We just return it. We can look it up for free, basically, in the memo. That's important. Then the debug here, just ignore it. It just prints out let's not ignore it, maybe. So what does it do? If our function is in debug mode, then what it does is, whenever we go past the memo checking here, the looking up in the memo, then we just print out that we are currently calculating the Fibonacci number for a given index. By the way, return memo, the index I, is also an example of the early exit pattern, meaning if we return the from memo here, this will not be executed. And then, what is down here? Well, down here is basically the same logic that we have seen in the recursive formulation of the Fibonacci function in chapter 4. The Fibonacci number function calls itself with I decremented by 1, and whatever we get back from here eventually will be added to the return value of Fibonacci of I minus 2 whenever that returns. And the problem back in chapter 4 was that it took forever until these two functions returned. That's what the exponential growth was. So, and then we store that in a variable called recurse. And then after calculating the value, what we do is, since we calculated it, we put it in the dictionary, in the memo, with the index I, and recurse is the solution, of course. And then we return the recurse value. In other words, this function does the following. Either we have calculated a certain Fibonacci number before, in which case we just look it up. And if we don't have done that, if we haven't done that before, we will actually calculate the number. However, we will only calculate every Fibonacci number only once at most. Because once we have calculated it, it's in the memo, and once it's in the memo, we never calculate it again. That's the solution to the exponential growth problem in chapter 4. And again, this only works because the memo allows us a constant time lookup with the keys via the hash function. So let's call Fibonacci of 12 and set debug to true. And now we get back 144, which is the Fibonacci number with index 12, the 13th Fibonacci number. And now the interesting thing is, if I make this call again a second time, I get back 144, but where's the debug info? The debug info is gone. What happens if I call it again? Well, I just get back 144. And what does that mean? Let's look again in the function. So whenever nothing is printed, we know we must have returned here. In other words, we did not calculate anything, right? That means if I don't see an output here, we didn't calculate anything. We just looked up the number. And that's, of course, true. Because in the global namespace, there is the memo dict. And if I look in memo, the memo now contains all the Fibonacci numbers from the indices 0 to 12. Now, that means if I call Fibonacci now again, it just doesn't run. It just looks up the number here. However, of course, if I calculate now, let's say, Fibonacci with the index 15, then three more Fibonacci numbers must be calculated. And if I now update or now look at memo again, three more numbers are in the memo. Okay? And if I run it again, just to illustrate the point, nothing is calculated anymore. Okay? So this is how the memoization works. It's like cheating. It's like we calculate the solution once, store it away, and whenever we need it, we just look it up. Okay, one reason why I don't like this function, whenever a function is called and changes a global object or something that is outside its function scope, we kind of don't like it. Because that means calling the Fibonacci function here has a side effect of changing the global memo. And the side effect is, of course, intended here. However, we don't like it. It's not good coding practices to do that. And so what I will not show here in this presentation, but what you can read in the chapter, is yet another implementation of the Fibonacci number, a function, where we also use memoization, but we don't have a global memo. And if you are curious to know how that works, you have to read it up in the chapter. And now, just the last bit of information regarding the Fibonacci. We said that the recursive formulation of the Fibonacci function is of exponential growth, which means it's super slow. And that means we couldn't calculate Fibonacci for large indexes. And the largest index for which we calculated Fibonacci back in chapter 4 was actually index 36, and that already took several seconds. Now I want to calculate the 100th Fibonacci number, and again, it works super fast. And if I want to calculate even a larger Fibonacci number, like the 1000th Fibonacci number, super, super fast, microseconds. And again, we get this speed from looking up the values in the dictionary. And this again, the speed, where does the speed come from? This would be a very good exam question. The speed comes only from the hash function that takes the object, the key, and transforms it into a hash value, which then determines in which bucket we put in the object or the reference to the object. Okay, so this is the first part chapter 8, there is a second part which is quite fast to go over. So we will just do that. So chapter 8 is called Mappings and Sets. And now we have extensively talked about mappings. And the main example of a mapping was the dict type. In this second part of chapter 8, you will find many specialized mappings. But I will not show them here in this presentation. But you should quickly read over it, because Python comes with the so-called collections module in the standard library, which contains many, many data types that are special cases or special subtypes of the dict type that model different things that the dict type doesn't. For example, they model a predictable order, one of them. There's one called counter, which you can use whenever you want to count things. And it's a lot more efficient when you are in this world. So there are many, many specialized data types. And you know, if you know what data type to use for a given problem, then oftentimes you can just solve the problem in a faster way, obviously. But now we are not looking into more mappings. So mapping is also, of course, an abstract concept, and the dict is just an example of it. Now we look at something else. We look at sets, and sets are really nothing new. We've actually learned everything we want to know about sets already. We just want to see a little bit more syntax of how we use them, but the theory regarding sets we all already know. So Python has a set type, and the set type models what in math we would also call a set. So, example, how do you create a set? Well, you put the curly braces there, and you will now say, well, wait a minute, curly braces, haven't we just used them for the dict type? And I will say, yes, we have. But the syntax for the dict type was a little bit different. In the dict type, we would also have colons, right, to map a key to a value. Here, we don't have colons. Okay, and then also note that these are the same 12 numbers that we see as always, you know, from starting the first chapter, the same example. However, see that within the curly braces, I have 2 7s, and at the end, I have 2 4s. So if this were a list or a tuple, this would not have 12 elements. It would have 14 elements, because the 7 and the 4 would be double. However, this is a set type. So let's create the set. And let's look at numbers. First, numbers is of course an object on its own. It has a reference. It has a type, which is set. And what's the value? Well, the value is really the numbers from 1 to 12. And now this is interesting here. So what you see here is first the 7. Is only in their ones, the 4 is only in their ones, so double entries don't exist. And also somehow the values, the numbers are ordered, right? And when I created numbers up in the first cell, it was definitely not ordered. So question is, what happened? And are numbers, is the set type ordered? So let's look at a different way to create sets. So the first way with the curly braces is called the literal notation again. And now we can also use the set constructor. And in order to create an empty set, I call the set constructor with no arguments. And now I have an empty set. Now, why can I not use the curly braces to create an empty set? Well, quite easy. If you put just two empty or just the curly braces without anything in between, you will, of course, create an empty dictionary. So Python doesn't know that you want to get a set and not a dictionary. So because of the double meaning of the curly braces, in order to create an empty set, you have to use the set constructor. And then, of course, how does the set constructor work? Well, if you read in the documentation, the set constructor takes any iterable. And of course, it has to be finite, so any finite iterable. So I give it a text string here, abracadabra. And what set does, it gives me back only the unique letters in the word. So that's what sets are good for. they work just as sets in math, and that means any object that exists can only be contained in a set once. And the important thing by what do we mean here is any object with regard to its semantic value can be in a set only once. That's really what we mean. So if we were to put the integer 1 into a set, and then we tried to also add the float 1.0 into the set, then at the end of the day, we cannot put the 1.0 into the set because the integer 1 and the float 1.0, they evaluate equal. They have the same semantic meaning to us. And because of that, only one of them can survive in the set, right? So some subtleties again here. And so how do sets work? Well, we should think of sets as if they are dictionaries, just without values. And that's the whole idea. When I told you what is a hash table, I said, okay, one downside is that a hash table uses very much, a lot of space unnecessarily, but we get speed because of it. But now, what is a set? Well, basically, a set is a hash table without the values part. That's it. So in other words, if we, and I'm not going to draw it, but if I were to draw it, a set would actually look like the list. The only thing that's different would be that in a list, we would always start to put in the reference from the beginning in an ordered fashion. And if we wanted to, put the references inside a set, we would have the same data structure, the same array type. But then we would also do the hashing for the objects that go into the set. And then the idea of how we put something into the hash table here for a dict is exactly the same as we put things into the set, into a set type, into the hash table that is underlying the set. So really, in all the theory from the dictionary also applies here, just without the value row here. So let's see what that means. That, of course, means I cannot put anything that is mutable inside the set. I will get a unhashable type error here. And then, that's, of course, it. And then what can we say with regard to the behavior? Well, sets are, of course, finite. They are sized. We can loop over them. And somehow, I seem to get an order here. And the only reason why I see that in order is because we saw that an integer, if we hash it, we get back the same number as its hash value. And the sorting inside a set is basically somehow related to the hash value. That's the reason, the technical reason why we see an order here, but there is no order, trust me. Just like there is no order for dicts, there is no order for sets. And now there's even one thing that is different between sets and dictionaries in a technical way. So we remember that in a dictionary, that we don't have a predictable order, but the dictionary is still able to remember the insertion order. However, a set is even more optimized, so a set does not remember the insertion order. The set really just is a thing that we use to make sure that we only have unique things in it. That's what the set is good for. And also, of course, the membership testing, looking up things, that is also what a set is very, very good for, because the lookup, the key lookup for sets works exactly in the same way as for dictionaries. And that's what we want to use sets for. So in other words, here we do have an order. It seems like we have an order, but we don't have an order. That's the entire point. However, we can still loop over it. So a set is still iterable. And now to see that a set has no order, we try to reverse it and see and want to see if it's reversible, but then we see a type error and it says the set is not reversible. But the container property is still there. So zero is not in numbers. And let's see if the integer one is in numbers, it is. And let's see, just to illustrate a point, if 1.0, the float, is in numbers. And the answer is true as well. So even though the float 1.0 is, of course, not in the set, because the set obviously only contains integers, the lookup works by value, by semantic value, and the semantic value of the 1.0 float and the one integer is the same. In other words, the 1.0 float and the integer 1 have the same hash value, which means they end up in the same bucket, which means they evaluate equal. And again, this operator, the in operator, which is called the membership testing operator, is super, super fast for sets. It was already super fast, as we saw in the haystack example for dicts, but it's, again, also super fast for sets. And that's what we use sets for. And now the problem is, because sets don't have an order, there is no way to look stuff up. So let's try to look up the first element, so to say, in the set. And of course, I get an error message. Type error, set object is not subscriptable. And the reason why? Well, because there is no order. Without order, the indexes don't mean anything. Sets are mutable. So let's look at some set methods. So let's see. Let's first just add another line of code. What is numbers? Well, it's the numbers from 1 to 12. So let's add the number 99. And now the 99 is in there. The add is basically like the append for lists. However, append means we put something at the end of a list. But because there is no order, there is also no end. That is why the method is called add. So even though the 99 is shown at the end, it's not at the end, really, because there is no order. And then update is the corresponding method to the list method extend. And extend takes an iterable and inserts all the elements of the iterable. But here for the set type, update takes also an iterable. So range 5 will give me back the numbers 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And they are now added to the set. But however, the numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4 are already inside. And because of that, only the 0 gets added. Okay. I can, of course, also remove numbers with the remove method. So let's say numbers.remove. Now the number 99 has been removed. And what happens if I call the method a second time? I get a key error. And now the key error, it may sound totally, you know, weird, but where are the keys? We don't talk about keys really if we talk about sets, but because of the same underlying implementation as dicts are, we see this error message that there is a key error. So now there is another method called discard, and the difference between remove and discard is the following. If I discard, let's say, the number 0, now the number 0 is gone. It's not in the list anymore, in the set anymore. But if I call discard again, I don't get an error message. So in other words, the remove method fails loudly, and the discard method fails silently. And now see, numbers only has the numbers 1 to 12. And now let's look at some set operations. So sets, they overload some of the so-called bitwise operators that we saw in the chapter 5 on numbers, for the integer type in particular. And why do they overload them? As we shall see, you know, as there is something called set theory from in the field of math. And maybe this I can draw to make it a little bit more intuitive. So let's go ahead and start with an example. We create a new set called numbers, which is the numbers from 1 to 12. We create another set, which is the 0 set, which only contains the 0. And then we create the set called evens, which contains all the even numbers from 2 through 12. So maybe let's do, what do we do? Let's do the following. Let's draw a box. And let's put the numbers in there, maybe the 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. And now we want to basically show Let me get another color. So we will take black as well. I need three more colors, so pardon me. So now what we do is I color all the numbers in the sets in the and that they are in. So first, numbers. The number set has the numbers 1 to 12. So the 1 would be in there, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. So that would be numbers. And then there is the set called 0. And let's do that here, 0. And this only contains the number 0. And then lastly, we have evens. And this contains the numbers, let's do this, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, and 12. Okay, so this is how the sets correlate to each other. And let's see, what can we do? Typical operations in math, in set theory is to take, for example, the union. And how can we do that? We can do that with the bitwise OR operator, which is the pipe character, which is also called union. So let's take the union of zero and numbers. And the union of zero and numbers means let's take all the numbers that are in red and or in black, or both. So this would be a set of all numbers from 0 to 12. So let's see. It works. And just to illustrate a point, we can use the operator, but we could also call this method here, the union method, on one of the two objects and get the same result. So I personally prefer the operators, but we could also use the methods. So for every operator in this, for the set, in the set case, there is also a corresponding method. But again, I think the operators look a bit nicer. And now we can also extend this. So we can take the union of all sets. And this will then, of course, be the same set here. Why? Because the green set is a true subset of the red set. So we don't get any new elements. Then what we can do is we can look at the intersection. The intersection of the black set and the red set is zero because there is no intersection. So what should be the answer? The answer is, of course, the empty set. And what character do we have? This is the bitwise AND operator, which is also sometimes called called the AND. I mean, this is basically what it looks like. And then we can also take the intersection of, let's say, numbers and evens, and this will be, of course, be only the evens. Well, because how do we see that? The evens are a true subset of numbers. So what is the set that contains numbers that are in both sets? So it's, of course, only all the numbers that are both red and green here. That's nice. We can subtract. So this is now an arithmetic operator. We can say numbers minus evens. This will give us back a set that contains all the elements that are in numbers but are not in evens. And these are, of course, the odd numbers, right? These are all the red numbers that are not crossed out in green. And we can take that around. We can take all the numbers that are evens minus the numbers. And this will, of course, also result in the empty set. And this difference, in other words, taking a difference is a symmetric operation. Asymmetric operation. So it depends on what we subtract. But of course, if there's a symmetric difference, an asymmetric difference, there is also a symmetric difference. And the symmetric difference uses the this sign here, the caret, which is also a bitwise operator. And this again gives us the symmetric difference. And the symmetric difference in set theory means all elements that are in one set but not in the other. So it's an exclusive either or. And this is how the operator works. And that's basically it. And then we only have, I think, one more slide. Yes, that's the last slide. Finally, set comprehensions. They work exactly like dictionary comprehensions, just that we don't have the colon here. Okay? And I think this here now, the set comprehension, looks very, very close to math, because that's usually what mathematicians say. They say some set is derived from some other set by some rule. So this is really as close as it gets to math. Okay, so this is it now the end of chapter 8. So again, it was quite a long chapter, but what did we learn? We learned that there are indeed collection types that are not sequences. So why were they not sequences? Because they didn't have an order, a predictable order. And mostly we talked about the dict type, the dictionaries. Dictionaries behave like functions. They are a mapping from access, from unique access to possibly not unique Ys. And you remember now, and this is an important idea, that dictionaries are implemented via a hash table. And a hash table means we waste, on purpose, we waste lots of space in memory, but we get a very good speed when we try to look up keys. So when we want to search for something in the hash table, that is super fast, and we call that a key lookup. And that's one of the primary reasons to use it. We've also seen an example of how a nested data structure looks like. This is what you will often see when you get data from the internet. And other than that, I think we have just seen a lot of things we can do with mappings. And also from concept-wise, programming-wise, we have learned about the idea of memoization, which allows us to finally make the recursions from chapter 4 that were rather inefficient back then. It allows us to model them in an efficient way. And when we continue the study of memoization, then we get into a field called dynamic programming. And this is, I think, super important because dynamic programming helps us to solve many, many problems in the field of supply chain management. Anything in logistics that has to do with optimization oftentimes can be solved with a dynamic program. And so knowing memoization is a good trick. And the sets, of course, may be helpful if we want to ensure that we only have unique elements from some set. So imagine you are given some data and you want to find out what are the unique things in this data set that you are given, then sets are your way to go. So you have seen many, many data types. Chapter 9, the next chapter will be on arrays and data frames. And arrays and data frames will put together what we have learned on sequence data and on mappings in a way. So the next chapter will put together the previous two. And yeah, so I will see you soon.